Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you all for coming. My name is Anton. I'm one of the floor managers here at Politics and Prose. And I am very excited to introduce Robert Pohl today with his new book, Urban Legends and Historic Lore of Washington, D.C. Robert is a historian, a tour guide, and the author of another local history book called Wicked Capitol Hill. And he writes columns for The Hill Rug and The Hill Is Home. And you might have guessed, he probably does live on Capitol Hill, am I right? I personally like local history immensely. And Urban Legends is an incredibly fun book, even if you're not sure if it's a cup of tea or if you haven't been in D.C. for that long. But really, is there a better way to learn about sort of this city than by reading about a bunch of stories that might have been made up during the city's history? And Robert does set out to investigate the origins of a whole slew of these urban legends. Are they true? I'll leave it to him to tell you or for you to find out from the book. Please welcome Robert Pohl.
Hi, thanks so much for coming out. This is great. So yes, my name's Robert Pohl and I'm a tour guide. I've been doing this for about 5 years now, chasing eighth graders around DC and hopefully getting them to understand a little bit about of our history and how our country works and all these other good things. In order to become a tour guide, you actually have to take a test, which is, I think DC and New York City are the only places that require that. And this test is very nuts and bolts, like, you know, where is the White House and how tall is the Washington Monument? I'm like, okay, these are all great facts to know. And I mean, I would like to impart a little bit to my kids, but I know exactly how eighth graders operate. After all, I was one not that long. Well, actually a long time ago. And I know exactly that, you know, I have a little kicker in my brain that when a fact comes in one ear, it kicks it right out the other ear. And I need some way of making this more palatable. And so I thought, well, stories. Everybody loves stories. And right around that time, a friend of mine, neighbor across the street, was moving. And so he was getting rid of a lot of books. And so he gave me a whole stack of books, DC-related ones, including one that had, you know, all these great stories. I'm like, oh, perfect. Like, the first story in there is all about how when the Washington Monument opened, they had an elevator in it, but elevators were considered dangerous at the time, so women and children were not allowed in the elevator. And so while the men got to be taken up to the top in whatever, 12 minutes, being served wine and cheese and crackers along the way, the women and children had to walk up around the outside, up along the steps that wrap around the elevator. And I'm like, perfect. This is the best story because you get all sorts of ideas about, like, first of all, about when it happened, how tall it is, and all these other things. It brings the Washington Monument a lot more, a lot closer to people. Especially, you know, today it takes, what, 90 seconds to get to the top, and it's like it's all very cut and dried. But here, this is what it used to be like. So I went to my friend Tim, who is the tour guide who got me into this whole thing. I said, Tim, I found this great story. And he was like, and that's when I realized, oh yeah, urban legends, that's right. I remember those. I actually used to not study urban legends, but I read a lot about them, read Jan Harold Brundtland's books and alt folklore urban, and I was just very intrigued by these stories, these supposedly true stories that the real ones, it's like supposedly true, spontaneously erupt, tend to be localized in different places and change over time. Have some kind of a moral. They sort of live in that, in sort of a connection between horror stories and jokes and morality tales. Anyway, when I was researching my first book on Wicked Capitol Hill, one of the stories that I was researching and I read about the murder of ex-Representative Talby in the Capitol. He was murdered by a newspaper reporter. And the story, as it's always told, is that Talby was a player. This was 1890s, but he was a player, and he soon met a young woman, got her a job at the patent office, and then he would go sneak away in, you know, the model room at the top of the patent office, and he and his paramour would go hide in there and canoodle or whatever one did. And he was caught, and this story was splashed through the newspapers by one Kincaid. And the next thing you know, he was ex-Representative Talby, stuck around in D.C. as a lobbyist, oh God, and thus kept running into Kincaid, and eventually they got into a fight that ended up with Kincaid killing Talby. Now, the story is really not that, like, I mean, that's a great story in that you have this, you know, this high flyer brought down and, you know, eventually pays for his sins. And, you know, the moral of the story is, well, first of all, don't canoodle with young women, not your wife. And second of all, don't become a lobbyist. And, oh, right. And then the coda of the story was that eventually his family changed, like his descendants changed their names so that they would no longer be associated with the name Talby. So I started researching that and realized that almost none of the story is actually true. What actually happened is that, yes, indeed, the fact that Kincaid killed Talby, that is true, and the fact that Talby was caught with this woman is true, but it really had no effect on his career. In fact, he probably could have been reelected again, but he decided not to because he was making way more money in real estate than he was making as representative. So he basically gave up the seat. Yes, there are stories in the newspaper back then going on, oh, what a horrible human being this is. But there were also plenty of them that were like, oh, he's the most popular man in Kentucky. So I realized, wait a minute, this story, there's a reason why this story changes, because the moral becomes really very diffuse by the time you get through the full thing. Oh, right. And he ended up being buried next to his wife. So clearly there was not a great deal of dissatisfaction with him at all. Anyway, so this made me realize that, oh, there are these urban legend-like stories that exist in D.C. And you know what? I bet there's a lot of them that I've been telling my kids. And maybe I should go back and I should research some of them. And a couple more stories. One of my favorites about... and this is actually interesting because the story turned out to be true, even though it seemed to be such an urban legend. The story that I was told was that the Lincoln Memorial was the only building hit by gunfire during World War II in Washington, D.C. Nobody would give any sort of reference to it. In fact, I found it in a book that a friend of mine had published. So I immediately emailed him and said, hey, what's your reference? He's like, I'm not so sure there. And so I was like, wait, maybe this never actually happened. Because if you look at all of the stories say, oh yeah, if you look at the plinth of the Lincoln Memorial, you'll see where it was. And I've looked at it many, many times. I've been there many, many times with my kids. I'm like, oh, is there anything? You can't, it's not obvious that there's one place that's been repaired. So I started digging through the archives of the Washington Post. They're online through the DC Library, and I searched like in every different way. And you know what? I actually found the article. Eventually, yes, it actually happened. That it wasn't really an anti-aircraft gun, or it wasn't. That's how it's always told. It was actually a machine gun that did it. The machine gun shot off four bullets. Three hit the Lincoln Memorial, one went over. And I found this article in the Washington Post, and the New York Times, and I think the LA Times and the Washington Star. So, I mean, it was mentioned in the newspapers of the day, and all of them are like, oh, yes, and there's going to be an investigation. But as far as I can tell, that investigation never happened. So the story stuck in people's minds, and it remained alive as almost as an urban legend, even though it was actually true. So I'm actually that was one of the more fascinating stories that I researched. What's another one? Oh yeah, I've been having a nice argument with people about William Howard Taft and the bathtub. So this is one that gets told all the time, that when Taft was president, and I mean, of course, these stories always have different variants, so I tend to tell my favorite variant of it. So in this case, William Howard Taft, you all kind of know he's a big boy, that the day that he was to be inaugurated got stuck in a bathtub in the White House, and they had to get a pound of butter and six husky men to get him back out of that. So again, you know, moral, don't be fat, you know, or whatever. which, by the way, William Howard Taft was perfectly aware of. He spent most of his life fighting his weight and, in fact, did manage to lose a fair bit after he left the White House. But the fact of the matter is he knew exactly what the deal was with him and bathtubs long before he became president. And in fact, after he was elected, but before he took office, he was on a trip that was taken on a Navy boat down to South America and back. And they actually built a special bathtub for him. It would fit four people. In fact, there's a very famous picture of four of the people that built the bathtub sitting inside it. That was put into the boat, and he eventually had that transferred to the White House. Now, the other thing is that if you were listening closely to the story as I just told it, you would immediately see that there's a major flaw in it. There's absolutely no way that Taft would have been stuck in a bathtub in the White House before his inauguration, because, of course, you only move into the White House afterwards. But again, it's a better story that way, right? Being stuck in a bathtub on your way to inauguration is much better than, oh, you got stuck once in his bathtub. So that was that was clearly not the case. Now, I did find an article where he was, this is well after he was president, he was in somewhere in New Hampshire, I think. He was in a hotel there, and he took a bath, and apparently the water sloshed out over the tubs and dripped down onto the people that were downstairs, and he sort of came down like, oh, sorry about that, guys, you know. But then the other thing that I discovered about this story, and this is where the real urban legend aspect comes in. I was saying how, you know, urban legends tend to be localized, i.e. you tell them about your town or your area because that makes it much more relatable. And if you look through, I found like six different places across the United States, invariably in hotels, in which he got stuck in a bathtub. So that's one case where there was a really urban legend aspect of the story came through very strongly. But then the only problem that I had with researching this and talking about this is, I mean, the other day I was doing an event with two friends of mine who also published books through History Press, and one of them had discovered that Mark Twain had written a letter from D.C. that was published, I think, in a Philadelphia newspaper, but not under his name. But he was able to prove that this was, in fact, Mark Twain's work, which is great. You know, next time they have a complete set of works of Mark Twain, that letter will be in it. And I was like, wow, you lucky boy. Because here's what happened. So another story I spent a lot of time researching was the lobbyist Ulysses S. Grant. So the story goes that U.S. Grant, when he was president, did not really enjoy living in the White House. He felt that he was held away from things that he liked to do, and he wanted to be out and about amongst people. So every evening, he would go over to the Willard Hotel, which is, you know, two blocks away, and he would hang out in the lobby. And people soon found out that if you want to talk to the president, any evening, Willard Hotel lobby, that's your chance. And so they would come by and they'd say, hey, you know, I really need a pension, or, you know, if you could pass a law that would ensure that, or whatever. Short end of story is that this is where the word lobbyist comes from. Now, this story has been debunked many, many times over the years, mainly by showing that the word lobbyist goes back well before Grant. In fact, it probably comes from Britain originally, and there's like 17th century uses of the word lobbyist. Not only that, the negative connotation of lobbyists was also already well established. One of my favorite Hill people, Olivia Briggs, was an early female journalist, and she published a screed against lobbyists in one of her columns, in which she talks about the serpent of the lobby writhing his way through Congress. And this was actually published before Grant took office. So clearly, it was not only was the word lobbyist well established by the time he took office, but it was well established as a very negative term. Okay, so that half of the story was clearly false. But what about the part of Grant hanging out in the Willard Hotel? So fortunately, I have a lot of online resources at my disposal that and searchable, which makes it easy. So the papers of Ulysses S. Grant in 25 volumes or something like that is available online. You can search it. And I searched through the years that he was president for Willard, and I found exactly 4 hits, none of which indicated that he was actually in the Willard Hotel. So I thought, well, that's kind of strange. Like, on the one hand, we have people that insist that he was there every night, and then here, there's absolutely no indication. You'd think that at least one person would have said, oh, yeah, I saw you at the Willard in the lobby the other night, and something like that. So I decided to follow the source back. Where does this story come from? It all came back to a 1954 book about the caravanserai of, that is, the Willard Hotel, sort of a history, hagiographic history of the Willard Hotel. And it said that, oh, well, that told this story and referred to an article in a Washington paper from 1869 where it said that in the evenings, Grant goes to the Willard Hotel. I'm like, oh, okay, well, that's pretty clear there. I mean, it's a little odd. This was very early in his presidency, and so maybe that had changed. But, you know, I should actually find this newspaper. And fortunately, again, Washingtoniana collection of the library came through, and they have that newspaper, and I found it. And basically, that quote was made up. The quote is actually, in the evening, he rides out. No word about the Willard whatsoever. So suddenly, like, this entire story has gone from being, you know, this great, you know, anti-lobbyist thing and whatever, and nice little history to this word, to absolutely nothing. Anyway, so I'm very excited about this. I mean, to me, this is like, okay, I've actually, you know, I've proven something here. And a few days later, I had a tour that started in the Willard Hotel. This happens frequently. They'll get a call, hey, you know, there's this group in town and they'd like a tour of whatever. And, you know, just meet them in the Willard Hotel and take it from there. So I was like, great. And, you know, I got my, you know, 15 people, 20 people together. We're always waiting for the last couple. And so I figure, you know, I can start talking a little bit about some things just to, you know, so they're not just standing around twiddling their thumbs. And so I'm like, perfect, I'm the Willard Hotel. I'll tell the Willard Hotel story. So I start by telling the story. And then I go on about how I did this research and about, and then how, you know, essentially as I just explained it to you. And I'm like, okay, great. You know, this is, you know, you learned something here today. And if at the very end, one of the women raises her hand and says, what was the story at the beginning again? That's the one I want to tell. That's when I realized that, yeah, Sisyphus had it easy. And so I'd love that, you know, I hope that you read this and understand this, but I also understand if you don't go, then tell the stories, because, hey, they are good stories, and we all do like good stories. So that's been about 20 minutes. I could tell more stories, or I can take questions. Any questions? Any answers?
If you do have a question, please use either of the audience microphones so we can also hear.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hi.
Does it work? Okay. In this book, do you tell more modern stories, like the shotgun stalker who was from Mount Pleasant? Have you ever heard of that?
No, the stories tend to be more historical. I think about up to Kennedy would probably be the latest story.
Oh, okay. This was 1990, so
okay.
In the early 90s. So, in Mount Pleasant, there was a guy, his name was Jimmy Swan. He went around and he was shooting people, like he would drive around in a car and
lovely.
There'd be people walking right. And he'd shoot them. Well, that's not a nice story, but eventually he was caught in somewhere. Was Scott said that he was a security guard
right
in D.C. and apparently he was a security guard in whatever building you were living, you were working in. So he was
right. So everybody who would tell the story is like, oh yeah, I knew this guy because he was a security guard.
Right.
That's this localization thing that happens. It's like we want to make the story more personal, more impressive by, oh, it happened right here. And that's one thing that comes up again and again. The other thing that I find, I didn't really mention it, but was this just sort of the search for patterns that we as human beings, we love patterns, and so we want to see patterns where they may not actually exist. So yeah, there's a lot of very basic human nature issues that are related here. A friend of mine who was visiting while I was working on this book is a psychologist, and he was like, oh yeah, there's actually been studies about how these stories, like which versions of stories end up going. And it's always the most dramatic. So again, I'm sure that, you know, like the guy who it was like, not only was he in my building, but I saw the shotgun one evening or something like that, you know, because that makes it more dramatic and greater impact.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So.
I actually have two questions. First is, about the history of Tenleytown, which, you know, this area here. I had read somewhere that it was, after the Civil War, a freed slave community. And that and it remained that well into the 20th century. And that once Alice Deal Junior High and Wilson High School, that had been a whole area that was raised.
Mm.
Do you know anything
about? I don't know. There's a lot of places like that. Pentagon was essentially that sort of area. So there were a lot of areas where freed slaves lived. They moved to this area in large numbers after the Civil War. Would often end up in their own areas like that. And then of course they would be ripe for when that land became needed for something. So I don't know exactly about Tenleytown, but it wouldn't surprise me at all.
I live near Fort Stevens.
Oh, okay.
And I was wondering if the Fort Stevens legend, you researched that. About
all right, how long do you have?
What I had heard was, you know, something that Lincoln was shot,
right,
or was being shot at. Somebody near him was, in fact, killed, and that somebody pushed Lincoln down. Yelling at him, "Get down, you fool!" And afterwards, Lincoln apparently was reported to have said, "Thank you for talking to your commanding officer that way, sir." That's the story I heard.
Good telling, excellent work. Okay, the story there are so many variants of the Fort Stevens story to cover all of them would take a book, and in fact there is an entire book about it. When I tried to boil this down into 800 words, I had great difficulties with it. But the canonical telling of it is that indeed Lincoln was up on the battlements there of Fort Stevens, and there were snipers, Confederate snipers down below, and they were shooting in his direction. Here we're talking a guy that's 6'2" and he's wearing a top hat. So, I mean, hey, if that's not a target, I don't know what is. And next to him was the General Wright, who was in charge of the troops that had been brought up there to support Fort Stevens, and a surgeon whose name escapes me right now. Anyway, a bullet ricochets off of the gun, hits the surgeon. He falls down, and then the story usually continues that somebody pulls Lincoln down, says, "Get down, you fool." And then is, of course, extremely chagrined about how he just spoke to his president. And the president comes over just before he leaves Fort Stevens and says, "Well, I'm glad to know that somebody still knows how to talk to civilians." The kicker of the story is that man was Oliver Wendell Holmes. Now, the historic record does not support this, unfortunately. So actually, a little bit of it. So the first of all, Lincoln actually was at Fort Stevens three times. One time before the Confederates got there, the second time when they were arriving, but were not attacking, and then the third time during as close to an actual attack as there was. There never really was a full-on attack on Fort Stevens, because by the time the Confederates were ready to attack, the Wright and his men had gotten there and were keeping Fort Stevens safe. So, but the first day obviously there was no fighting, so that nothing really happened there. The second day, it was probably a soldier who told Lincoln, you know, you really probably should get down from where you are. I name a name. The likelihood that it's actually him is, oh, I don't know, 5 or 10%. And I'll get to why this is so uncertain in a minute. And then on the third day, he came back, and it's almost 100% clear that it was General Wright himself who said, look, I know you're my commanding officer, but I'm in charge of this place, and I need you to get down. And Lincoln, in fact, did so. The problem is that there are only three diary entries or whatever that were written at that time, two of them by John Hay, who wasn't even there. He was at the White House. Now, he probably heard from Lincoln what had happened, and so he wrote it that night, and so that's about as close as you're going to get. And the final one was Lincoln's Secretary of the Navy, who was there, but only after he had been told to get down, and when Lincoln was sort of sitting with his back to the wall. So all the other stories were not written down until like 30 years later. And I think part of the problem was that most of the people that went through the Civil War weren't interested in writing down what was going on right when it was going on. And it took them a long time before people started to say, hey, wait, what actually happened there? And you're not getting any younger, and maybe you should write that down. And so that's why I found probably a dozen different eyewitness accounts, but they were all written much, much later. So, and then what happened is that Oliver Wendell Holmes started telling the story that it was he who had done that. Now, the problem is that on the third day, when it was almost it was clear that was General Wright who told Lincoln to get down, or I should say the day before, Oliver Wendell Holmes wasn't there because when a soldier did tell him to get down, because Holmes was Wright's aide-de-camp, so he would have only gotten there the third day. And the third day was clear that it was Wright who told him to get down. So, what's clear is that Lincoln did come under fire there, and that somebody was shot next to him, or at least injured, that he was told to get his head out of the line of fire because he really was in danger there. But it's a little less of a – I mean, we don't know the – true details, and the story itself is a little less has a little less oomph than it being Oliver Wendell Holmes.
Okay. My question was, when you first decide to research a story, do you have a sense of whether or not it's you think it's true or false, and then how does that kind of guide you or influence the way you actually research it?
Well, as I said with the Lincoln Memorial story, I was actually I was surprised to find that it really was true. I try to keep as open a mind as possible because I don't want to miss anything. And sort of with the Washington Monument story, I did find what I think might be the kernel of truth there, in that there was a time after the Washington Monument was completed, but before they actually started running the elevator, there were like 4 years where you did have to walk up the Washington Monument, but that was everybody. It wasn't like men were separated from women. I don't know if maybe that, you used to have to walk up the monument, somehow got merged with something else, and to make that, I don't know. I try to keep as open a mind as possible because I've been surprised, and the thing is that in contrast to most urban legends, which have no truth to them, they're just good stories. I did find that there was often a real element of truth there. Yeah.
I've been on tours in D.C. and New York City, and I've had guides claim both stories as belonging to that city. So I want to see if you've...
Go.
No. One is on the first time the insanity defense was used. In D.C., we say it's the guy who found the lover climbing out of the window of his house at Lafayette Park and shot him, and that's what they use. And I was on a tour in D.C. in New York, and they said the same thing. And then where JFK proposed... to his wife. There's a table at Martin's Tavern, and then there's also, I was in a restaurant in New York, and they claimed that this is the booth where he proposed. So if you know,
you know, the, actually the yes, I've always heard the insanity defense here as well. To be honest, it didn't until you just said that, I didn't realize that there were sort of multiple tellings of this and that this would be something that would be worth researching. And I'm going to make a note of that. I've already gotten enough or almost enough stories for a second edition of this book. And it's great because I hear things like this. Now. And then the more you look for these things, the more you find them, too. So I actually, yeah, I need to look that one up. As far as the Kennedy one, that's already on my list. And the reason is that not only there's three different ways here in D.C. There's two different booths at Martin's. And then there's another one that claims that he proposed to her via telegram. So clearly one of these, you know, there's only one that can be true if at all. So, I mean, so clearly that's another story that needs more research. But I did not know that it was a New York. Well, of course they would, right? Everything happens in New York, right?
There's an Irish bar in New York.
You know, it was a guide reference, and I just remember being shocked of, wait a minute, Martin has the plaque on the table. So,
okay, I'll have to look into that. That's awesome. Great. Thanks.
Hi. Thinking back to the issue of crime, I guess the first question got me thinking about this. I mean, I've heard some interesting stories about, you know, D.C. and, you know, say the beginning of the 20th century, you know, as I think D.C. was really kind of, becoming a bigger city, and you had these, you know, huge communities where crime was getting to pretty incredible levels. Then, of course, add on top of that the beginnings of Prohibition,
right.
Of course, D.C.'s own Prohibition experience. I mean, I've heard some pretty funny stories about the crazy things, you know, senators and congressmen who were sneaking alcohol right into D.C. I don't know. I was just wondering what stories have you heard, or maybe what's the most fantastical one you've heard? Hopefully, with at least some true elements.
Right. Well, actually, the you have to go to my previous book for the man with the green hat. Or even better, Garrett Peck's book on Prohibition in D.C. But yeah, actually, there's no need to go to urban legends to find ridiculous stories there. So the man with the green hat, and I mean, you may recognize that name, Green Hat Gin, and there actually also used to be a bar called the Green Hat on Capitol Hill. Anyway, they all refer to the same guy. He was the bootlegger to Congress, and the most famous story was that he was carrying in a suitcase full of booze into the House office building, and the one Capitol police officer who wasn't in on it said, "What's in that?" And so he walks into one office and sort of leaves it at a desk and then walks across the hall. And anyway, it's a little unclear what happened there, but the bottom line was that eventually it was, oh, it's yours and it's full of booze. And, it turned out he got at a slap on the wrist there because you didn't want to figure out that he had been getting booze to all these representatives, including very, very dry representatives, ones that voted dry, because the thing is that back then the Temperance League they cared only one thing about a representative senator, which is how are they going to vote? Are you going to vote dry or wet? I don't care what you do on your own time, as long as your vote in Congress is for prohibition. You know, go ahead and do whatever you want. So anyway, so you had all these people that. Or take the money from Temperance League and vote dry and themselves were complete lushes. I mean, the guy had a little office in the basement with a water spigot so that he could, like, you know, parcel out the booze that he'd brought in. He just went up to New York and get it there and bring it back. But yeah, anyway, so he was eventually caught, got a slap on the wrist, and immediately started going to the Senate and selling booze in the Senate because it was a little too risky at the House, so he worked at the Senate. So yeah, that was that's sort of the man with the green hat is a great George Cassidy, a great character in DC crime history. Oh, and the best part is that we know all of this because the Washington Post ran like a week-long front page series of articles about him. This was as Prohibition was clearly on the wane, but this was one of the things that came out. It's like, oh, look, all of your representatives are lushes. So, you know, come on. Why should you not get any? So,
Is there truth to the story about Winfield Scott's horse?
Which
operation it had to have?
Yes. So the problem was that when Winfield Scott's horse was equestrian statue was put in, sharp-eyed people noticed that it was a mare, and he had always had a stallion, and so they went back and they added one. I didn't actually research that one. Again, that's one that's on my list. What I did research was the hoof code. So if you'll often hear that you can tell from a statue, an equestrian statue, what happened to the person sitting on it. If two legs are in the air, they died in battle. If one is in the air, they were injured in battle but not killed. If all four are down, then they survived all their battles unscathed. I went through the 37 equestrian statues in D.C. and Arlington Cemetery of 35 different people, and discovered that in exactly one-third of the cases this was true, which is what you would expect from just sort of randomness. So, but again, the kernel of truth, which makes the story interesting, is that there was a time and a place where it was true, and that is Gettysburg Cemetery. And in fact, the first sort of dozen statues or so that were placed there, first dozen equestrian statues that were placed there, it happened to be true. And they eventually people started, you know, using this as an easy way of remembering it. And So when then recently they wanted to add one more equestrian statue, a very different one, which of someone who was not killed in battle, but they wanted an action shot of the horse. And so people are, but. And so they actually had to go back and say, no, there's no truth to this. There's no rule. There's certainly no law. There's nothing that says that this has to be true. And they found, you know, the papers of the guys that had previously done statues, and they're just, yeah, this looked good. That's why I did it this way or whatever. And so, but there was a time when, yeah, it was easy to remember what happened to the rider from the horse's statue, but that was Gettysburg. So,
hi. With income inequality so much in the news, I love that Georgetown people kept the 98.99.5% out by not building a metro station. Right. But then I was told that actually isn't true; that it was really the water table. So I want to keep the other story. But what is the real story?
Okay. This is a story that my buddy Tim and I have, like, I mean, we were at Peregrine the other morning. I think we went at it for 2 hours, okay? And it's a fascinating story. Okay, so the story is that when they were building the metro in D.C., the people of Georgetown were worried that those people might use the metro to come to their nice little enclave, and therefore they fought tooth and nail to keep it out. Now, the fact of the matter is that there really never was a plan to put a stop into Georgetown. But, and this is where Tim comes in, the other thing is that the Georgetown residents were against it. There's no doubt. There's a 1962 paper that they wrote saying, we don't want a metro here. Now, was that enough for them just to back off and say, all right, whatever? Or was or were they like, no, we really didn't want it here. What are you getting so exercised about? We don't know that exactly. It certainly would have been complicated. I believe, I mean, my take is, if Georgetown had really, really wanted a metro, they might have gotten one, because the metro was changed according to residents' wishes. But and how much the planners really just like, all right, forget it. But there are no, or there's exactly one map, sort of a planning map that that shows a Georgetown stop, but Even the other like highway people didn't like that one. It wasn't even that didn't even get to the Georgetown people for them to complain about. The people that were they would have had to put the metro over the river there, and that would have gotten in the way of the highways, and so the highways didn't people didn't like it. So to really if they had wanted to put one in, yes, there would have been an enormous amount of yelling and screaming. There are people that went to their deathbeds insisting that they were the ones that kept the metro out of Georgetown. So you know, no doubt about that. So it's a fascinating story, and the problem is, and this is where it starts getting, you know, the next level of complexity, is that that people started to really, really believe the contrary. So that there are some people that insist that there was no fight against the that there was nobody against the metro in Georgetown. That it was entirely because of these things, because it would have been difficult to build or whatever. So you have some people that have a vested interest in saying, oh, no, there was never any plan. It's like, well, actually, there sort of was. I mean, I can't imagine that when they were designing the metro here, that they didn't look at every single neighborhood in the city and say, does this neighborhood need it or not? And I think that given what they were building there, which is a method for people to get from the suburbs to their jobs in the city, there was no need for a metro stop in Georgetown. Somebody somewhere along the line made that decision that no, Georgetown doesn't get it. So it was on the table at some point. And how much the Georgetowners complaining about it really had any impact, I don't know.
I just think it's fascinating. I mean, we knew that story in New Jersey long before we moved here. So right, that's how much we hate rich people in America.
Well, the other thing is that, I mean, Georgetown, it's, you know, today is kind of this is a rich enclave, or that's what we see it at. But it actually used to have, you know, poor stretches down in the industrial section between the canal and the Potomac. So, I mean, Georgetown has changed a lot, and since 1962, it's changed a lot as well. So, any other questions? Yes?
You know, there are all these rules for getting buried in Arlington, right, and they've gotten stricter over time. Right. But if you go into Arlington Cemetery and you turn right at the big gate and go around the far edge, you'll see a lot of stones that just say citizen.
Yes.
And the story is that some of the sort of early on, that's one of the stories, is that when it was converted to, when they took it over to be a grave, one of the commandants was determined that Lee not be able to return. And he moved freed black, the graves of freed black residents.
Right, right, right.
From down near the water up to near the house, so that Lee would never want to, so that Mary Lee could never get her.
Right.
But I'm wondering, are those graves also freed blacks? Are they slaves who fled? Are they, I mean, do we know anything about it? It just says citizen.
Right.
Way off. They're not that story is
actually sort of merging two real stories. Yes. That's interesting. I hadn't heard that. So the story is that when they started building Arlington Cemetery, Montgomery Meigs got the okay from the from Congress to do it, because, I mean, D.C. was, during the Civil War, essentially one big hospital, and we have a big hospital, a lot of dead people, especially back at that time. So we needed a place to put them. So Montgomery Meigs, who was in charge of the part of D.C. across the river, the part that the Union Army had taken across the river, said, hey, we got a lot of open space here, and it's Robert E. Lee's place, so perfect. And so he went and he got permission for it. And when he returned, the soldiers were like, hey, we already started interring some people. In fact, the first one to be interred was a guy named William Christman, who died in Lincoln Park. Well, what is today Lincoln Park? Anyway, and they proudly said, yeah, we put him way, way over there. And Meigs was like, what are you talking about? I don't want him over there. I want him right here in Mrs. Lee's Rose Garden. So in the middle of the August sun, again, so the story goes, they took a dozen dead soldiers and buried them right around Lee's Rose Garden. You can still see those there. Now, with the slaves there, or the freed slaves, the freedmen that are just citizen, what that was is, remember I told you that that the Pentagon was built on what was probably a freed slave community, and they had a small cemetery there. When they built the Pentagon, they moved those into Arlington. So those would be the ones that just say citizen. Today, of course, there's no chance of that. But back then, hey, closest cemetery, let's put them there. Yeah.
Last question?
Yeah. It's probably a decent last question in the sense that it's a philosophical one. So,
okay.
So I'm a licensed guide. I'm sure there are more than a few licensed guides in the audience right now. And I tell a lot of stories just like you, because I think that's the way to get the story across, really, to keep people fascinated and interested. And I know sometimes I take liberties with story. here's the thing. You sit in front of the Lincoln Memorial, and you'll hear 100 different explanations of the Lincoln Memorial
right.
on any given Saturday in peak
right,
season.
Right.
And my question to you is, at what point do you think it's appropriate to go ahead and maybe make the story a little bit more interesting to keep somebody's attention so at least they get the point?
Well, I had a talk at Washingtoniana, and actually it was like all tour guides there. It was slightly disconcerting. It's like, guys, we talked about it for a while, and somebody says, well, I guess I'll just say story has it that, and then proceed to tell the story. I try to make the stories as true as possible without losing the story aspect of it. I also admit that there's a story that I have refused to research because I was worried it's false and then I'd have to stop telling it. So, I mean, I'm as guilty as everyone.
Which story is that?
And so what?
Which story is that?
Oh, it's the one that... Sorry, this will be a while. No. Jefferson Memorial. So the story is that, of course, the Jefferson Memorial postdates the cherry blossom trees there. So when they're going to start building that, there were a bunch of cherry blossom trees that were going to be torn down. And so the little old ladies who like to complain about things came out in force and chained themselves to the cherry blossom trees the morning that they were supposed to come and start bulldozing them. The chief of police of D.C. was told to go deal with this. And the chief of police knew darn well that you don't win any points for anybody by bonking little old ladies over the head. And so he came up with a better plan, and he served them coffee. Half an hour later, the protest was over. That's the story, and I'm sticking to it.
I'll buy it.
Okay, then. All right. Oh, one more here.
Okay. Again, about the metro.
Yes.
I heard that the original plan was to run along Connecticut Avenue to Wisconsin, to Chevy Chase Circle, but it was diverted from Barnes to Wisconsin because the residents near Chevy Chase Circle didn't like it.
That's quite possible. In fact, that is the other part of the Georgetown Metro story. I did not research that. I actually only recently became aware of that aspect of it. The only place that I know for certain where residents complained and managed to change it was actually Oklahoma Avenue, which is at RFK Stadium. And the idea was to basically send it along along the edge of RFK Stadium parking lot, right along Oklahoma Avenue, and then you'd have people driving into the parking lot, park there, and then take the metro the rest of the way. And the people didn't like the idea that they'd have a metro right underneath their house. Now, the fact of the matter is there's no metro stop there anymore. The closest one is the stadium one, which is, you know, a mile away. I suspect that the people that own the houses along Oklahoma Avenue today are very disappointed that this happened. But so I know that there were instances, at least that one instance, where citizen complaints did change the routing. I unfortunately didn't know about this one when I was researching the book, so it would have been an interesting question. But yes, I have heard that, and I don't know exactly what happened. And again, I mean, to reiterate, '62 was when the Georgetown residents started getting up in arms about the possibility. And it wasn't until 67 that the first subway map was actually presented to people as, okay, this is a possibility here. So there's 5 years where I'm, you know, it's not clear what was going on behind the scenes as far as routing the metro. Okay, well, thank you so much.